Hi, I'd like to tell you about this formal semantics that we've been developing. Before getting to why we're excited about it, let me introduce the programming language that we formalize. I suspect you've heard about the LLVM compiler infrastructure before. It's well known, for instance, to be at the center of the C-Lang compiler, but really it has been used for a variety of both academic and industrial projects. It's a humongous project as a whole, but in particular at its core is a programming language, the so-called LLVM IR. For intermediate representation. This language has been designed to be extremely suitable for analysis and program optimization, while being low-level enough for backends. It's a control for graph-based language in so-called single static assignment form with low-level instruction. So it looks simple enough. However, one hint that is not that simple is simply to look at the amount of work that our PL community has performed to try to find this language. In particular, a huge variety of works have been looking for understanding and formalizing the semantics, or simply some aspect of the semantics. But even just understanding the memory model has proven to be particularly tricky. And this kind of line of work have given rise to the principal tools to find bugs in LLVM as such. The specific line of work that we are based on in particular is called Velum, a project that was started in 2012. The idea of Velum was to provide a formal semantic in the code profile system of LLVM IR. It was a success, a significant subset of language was formalized, and even better, complex optimizations have been proven with respect to these semantics. But after this initial success, Velum has proven extremely hard to evolve, and in contrast, LLVM IR was evolving extremely fast. So in a sense, the gist of this paper is to provide new foundation for Velum, to revive it, and to do so under this idea that we would like to have a project able to keep up with a realistic language. There are, of course, many answers to such a difficult problem, but the angle in particular that we will take here is a semantic angle. So let me give you a very rough approximation as to how the semantics of Velum used to be shaped. The idea is to be parameterized by the whole programs with respect to which you are considering the semantics. Let's call it G for graph. And to use program counters to know dynamically where inside of this graph you are currently executing. Of course, you will also thread the memory. The first thing that we don't like with this approach is that if you consider a program transformation, you will of course modify G. We will therefore have to relate two programs with respect to basically two different semantics. And we will have to design invariants that explain how these program counters relate before and after optimization to compensate. More generally, you lack compositionality. Another aspect is that a single relation is encompassing all the aspects, all the effects of your semantics. If you modify one part of it, it's therefore extremely hard to know what part of the development will break. You lack modularity. And finally, intrinsically, this semantics does not compute. It is a relation. It goes into prop in the Coq lingo. It therefore lacks executability, and if you want to perform testing, you will have to work extra hard. In this work, we therefore rebuild Velum with completely different semantic tools. We use interaction trees, which are a library introduced last year at Purple. The idea of interaction trees is that a computation, it's dynamic, is represented as a potentially infinite trees. If you consider here, for example, a computation that may interact with a state, you will therefore potentially have silent step that you do not observe in your computation, but also observable events that are essentially requests to the environment to answer a question. What value should I get if I read X? Depending on this value, a continuation will explain how the computation will continue, for instance, terminating by returning a result, or potentially diverging. More specifically, if we try to understand how one can use interaction trees to give the semantics to a language, the idea would be in two steps. In the middle part, you have the representation of your program as one of these trees. Here, for instance, consider a program that will write a certain value to X, then read back from X, and write whatever value you get back to Y. Of course, intuitively, you expect your read to X to get 1. However, at this stage, events do not have any semantics. That is in the second part, that's very much the style of algebraic effects, if you're familiar with that. The handler will define the semantics of these events. The semantics defined in an appropriate monad, so that after this phase of interpretation, you obtain a computation that now can reduce. You couple that with the first phase, where the syntax of your program is represented as one of these interaction trees. You therefore get at a high level a general recipe if you want to define the semantics of a language A, write, of course, its syntax, but then inventory the effects that your language may have. You will categorize these effects into various interfaces, and you will put them together. Then you will represent the syntax as these non-interpreted interaction trees over this event interface. The library will provide combinators that help you do so in a compositional way. After that, each of these categories of events are implemented in an appropriate monad. And because you handle each of these categories of events separately, you obtain some modularity. Finally, because interaction trees do not go into prop, they are a co-inductive data structure, you may still extract the result and get an interpreter that you can execute in OCaml. Now, one of the messages of this paper is that this simple recipe essentially scales. In the case of LLVMIR, inventorying the effect leads to this signature made of 9 domains of events. And for instance, behind this ME is hidden all the interaction with the main model. I will not be able to describe how we represent the syntax as one of these trees. All the details are in the paper if you're interested. But the message is that these combinators are expressive enough that you actually are able to do the whole job. Finally, I would like to give you a little idea from a bird's eye view of the structure of the semantics once you handle all of these events. The idea is that you start from the syntax, as we said, of VIR, and you will first have this structural representation into one of these non-interpreted trees. But from there, you will basically build a stack of interpreter that will peel away each of the effects incrementally. First, you implement what is called intrinsic, a peculiarity of the language, and then you start introducing the pieces of state that you will manipulate. The global environment first, then the local environments, finally the main model, and here you have a handler that is isolated that implements the whole memo model with respect to which reason. At this stage, an interesting phenomenon happens. It turns out that LLVMIR, because of so-called undervalued and undefined behaviors, is not a deterministic language. We therefore capture in a propositional model all of the legal executions by defining two specific handlers. However, I told you that we wanted to be executable, so sharing all of the semantics except for these two handlers, we define two alternative handlers that are executable and that will be used in order to get a reference interpreter. Because we share so much of the semantics between both of the executable interpreter and the propositional model, we essentially get for free a refinement proof showing that the executable interpreter exhibits a legal behavior with respect to the model. At this stage, we have defined a formal semantics, but an important question is to ponder whether there is any relationship between these semantics and what we were interested in modeling, that is LLVMIR per se. Of course, to answer this question, we leverage this ease that we have to test because of this extracted interpreter. So we have an unverified parser that takes a valid LLVMIR syntax as input, feed it to the extracted interpreter, and finally feed the resulting tree to obtain your OCaml driver that will crawl the tree to extract the result. We cover a realistic sequential subset, and are, of course, happy to take feature requests. We have performed some differential testing against CLang over a collection of manually written unit tests, handful of significant problems that come from the front-end, but also some randomly generated programs. Now, this is about fidelity. The other question is whether this semantics is any more useful than the previous one. One reason we believe so is that interaction trees come with a notion of weak Bayes simulation that greatly characterize when two computational representative trees are equivalent. Through this representation function that we have, we therefore get the first notion of equivalence of programs. And this notion of equivalence of programs is playing well with the compositionality of the semantics, allowing us to have a battery of structural equational lemmas that characterize the semantics of the language in terms of its syntactic subcomponents. In particular, we can reason about open control flow graphs. For instance, here illustrating on a simple example, the semantics of a control flow graph can be expressed, can be reduced to the semantics of one of its subcomponents if we check whether syntactically or through a more semantic proof that there is no way to re-enter the other part of the graph. In the paper, we illustrate the use of this equational theory to provide a quite satisfying proof of a simple block fusion optimization. Now, if we come back to the structure of the semantics, that was organized as this stack of interpreters that introduce progressively into state monads pieces of the state and then the propositional model. Well, it turned out that this structure corresponds also to a stack of fulfillment relations that are included one into the other as a stack of growing relations. When you introduce a state, you get therefore a notion of equivalence in this monad, and then when you introduce a propositional model, you start working up to state inclusion. Interestingly, the block fusion proof does not depend on the state at all, purely in terms of the control flow, and it can be established at the very first level before giving any semantics of the state events, and therefore before introducing any concrete state. However, because of this stack of inclusion, the result can be transported all the way down. Now, of course, in general, you are interested in reasoning about the state concretely, in particular when you want to understand the semantics, of course, of your instructions. Since each instruction is implemented as a non-trivial tree, what we do is to provide an abstraction. We give, equationally, a characterization of the semantics of each of the instruction in an axiomatic way. Once we have done that, we can make the representation function completely opaque and reason more at a higher level of abstraction about the language. Concretely, it gives us two main reasoning ingredients. The first one is this combination of strong equivalences that we have at the VIR level. We have equivalences about the syntactic structure of the language, about the control flow, but also about the instruction, expression, and terminators. When we put all of this together, it gives us some kind of symbolic interpreter that we can run by rewriting during any refinement proofs. Actually, these refinement proofs can be performed from VIR to VIR, but also in an heterogeneous way when interfacing with other languages for a front-end or a back-end, for instance. And in particular, when we do so, what we get is a primitive relational program logic that, in particular, is compatible with this symbolic interpreter. We are therefore able to combine both of these ingredients to have interesting compositional construction of refinement proofs by equational means. We have been conducted a major case study in order to validate this approach. Helix is a formalization of something called Spiral, that is a pipeline to generate high-performance code for numerical computation. Helix is a formalization in Coq of Spiral, and chose to target Vellum as its backend. In itself, it has a complex compilation chain that is using diverse techniques to ensure correctness. But at the very bottom, its last intermediate representation, called FHCall, targets Vellum, our formalization of LLVIR. In order to prove this last pass, that is a compilation from a high-level language down to LLVIR, we have used this technique, giving a semantics based on I3s to FHCall, proving it equivalent to its previous semantics, and using this technique combining equational rewriting with relational program logics in order to prove the correctness of this compilation path. To wrap up, this paper is about the revival of Vellum, a formal semantic to LLVMIR, formalized in the Coq proof assistant. This new version of Vellum is based on a semantic tool called interaction trees that we use in order to gain interesting properties, compositionality, modularity, and a verified interpreter for free. Furthermore, reasoning about semantics allows for a very compositional and equational style of proofs for refinements. Of course, defining a formal semantics is just the first step. Now that this foundational ground is laid, we are excited to apply it to various use cases, but we would be even more interested if any external contributor would love to join us in this adventure.